Well, welcome and good afternoon to all of you. Thank you all for making possible this big summit of digital contents. The Minister of Communications and Information Technologies. These 3 days we have had more than 30,000 participants on streaming. We give a big hug or a greeting to those who are listening to us in the streaming. We have more than 100 conferences, 80 lecturers of 14 countries and the continents, and the attendees have taken over the zone here, the hotels, the restaurants, to talk and chat and connect themselves to the digital industry. Before starting the panel, I want to make a very special recognition to our allies and sponsors. Without them, we wouldn't have this event competing at international event. Thanks to ETB, El Tiempo, VVVA, Cine Colombia, and the Chamber of Commerce of Bogota, SENA, the Ministry of Culture, the High Advisory to the Ministry of Technology, Industry, Universidad Nacional ICDEA. My name is Mauricio Bejarano, and I'm honored to introduce you to this select group of national and international experts. They are friends of Colombia, they are friends of technology. Here to my right-hand side, I have Gil Gomez. Some of you have seen him some days, transmedia producer who has worked in large or big productions in Hollywood, including Pirates of the Caribbean, Avatar, Men in Black, Spider-Man, among others. To his right, Jorge Restrepo, director of the Mintic. Natalia Risa, director of Integral Education of SENA, and John Random, pioneer in strategic communications on a global basis. John has advised heads of state, high officers of the government, high executives and presidents, CEOs in more than 90 countries. And we have Mauricio Trujillo, high advisor in the district for the tech, information technology engineer and a specialist in software. And the rules of this panel and the purpose is to do something at the end of this event is a little more informal. The idea is to invite our lecturers to make some reflections on the role of technology in the transformation of societies. This is an informal chat. Make believe that we are in a dinner with very interesting friends. Each panelist will be given a question and they will answer 3 or 4 or 5 minutes. After that answer, we will open it up for a discussion of all the panelists during 5 or 10 minutes up to the next question. So, are you ready? Jeff, we start with you. Jeff?
En los últimos 2 días usted ha estado hablando a toda Colombia sobre oportunidades para transmedia, especialmente en entretenimiento y publicidad. Sin embargo, usted también ha hablado en el mundo acerca del potencial de transmedia en términos de transformación social y la política pública. ¿Puede usted darnos sus ideas sobre cómo pueden utilizar las herramientas de transmedia en un contexto y algunos ejemplos, 1 o 2, completamente?
Hay una cantidad enorme de evidencia de que los medios masivos pueden en realidad ayudar a cambiar la opinión en la sociedad. En los 70s, en Estados Unidos, tuvimos un programa de televisión que se llamaba All in the Family. Era una comedia. Se suponía que debíamos reír sobre eso, pero el argumento del programa era la raza. Y eso nunca había sido discutido antes en la televisión de esa forma. Esto permitió que nosotros nos riéramos, pero también habláramos entre nosotros acerca de la raza. Eso abrió una conversación. En Sudamérica hubo una telenovela que se llamaba Simplemente María. Y esta trataba de una muchacha de servicio que estaba sujeta a la brutalidad de sus empleadores, era muy triste y fue llevado en las mujeres sudamericanas algo que nunca se había tratado o se había hablado de eso, pero todos conocían.
María escapa de esta situación tan terrible estudiando por la noche, educándose ella misma y permitiéndose de esa forma salir de la situación. Como resultado de esta telenovela, millones de mujeres sudamericanas fueron a estudiar durante la noche, donde nunca lo habían hecho, educándose ellas y liberándose. Y avanzando en el movimiento femenino en Sudamérica, no muy tarde después de que sucedió en los Estados Unidos. Yo pienso que hay muchos ejemplos en donde múltiples plataformas de medios crean movimientos. Algunos de estos son espontáneos, se organizan por sí mismos y ellos utilizan Twitter o Facebook en forma o medios más convencionales para comunicarse entre ellos, para poder mencionar o darle voz a su insatisfacción con el gobierno o con el Estado o la sociedad. Si usted estudia esto más cercanamente, usted podría discernir que hay una metodología para crear esa activación de la población sin necesariamente moverse a la sangre o a tener interrupciones muy terribles o movimientos o motines. Yo creo que Transmedia, la narrativa y la producción de Transmedia, podría permitir una sensibilidad de diseño de lo que pasa detrás de la activación de la población y permitir que las personas que eran anteriormente invisibles, cuyas voces no podían ser escuchadas, que repentinamente pudieran contar sus historias a sus gobiernos, a ellos mismos, pero también al resto del mundo. Porque cuando usted cuenta historias al mundo y el mundo está escuchando, en realidad hace que su sociedad se comporte mejor, al menos un poquito. Usted tiene que estar en su mejor comportamiento cuando las personas lo están viendo. O si no, se vienen unas sanciones a la nación y serán desconectados de la economía global. Entonces, hay una aplicación. Lo mismo que hace que Avatar o Spider-Man, el Hombre Araña, sean populares en el mundo por múltiples plataformas de medios, eso puede ser aplicado, yo creo, a los temas sociales y a la política, de forma tal que podamos comunicarnos entre nosotros mejor, ser más transparentes y permitir que lleguen las soluciones en donde ambas partes se sientan que han sido escuchados. Esa es la belleza de la tecnología que se está esparciendo por Colombia hoy en día. Gracias. ¿Alguien más? Anyone wants to start making comments? John. Perhaps. I don't know if in Colombia, since you are so close, have you seen any indication of this starting to happen, or you see it just in entertainment advertisement? What have you seen in the region? I imagine that you see in Latin America. From the government part, we have started to develop some projects in which the mass media is used for certain causes. One example is a radio soap opera that was made for the guerrilla groups to demobilize. That's what was behind there, as I was telling yesterday. The message was, it was not straight, but it was on a family that was suffering a lot because their son had gone as a guerrilla man and their lives changed. There is a very happy ending when this guerrilla man is demobilized.
That is one of the examples, but also public broadcasting radio is starting to develop and see that this world is changing. Same with public television. For example, Señal Colombia has miSeñal.tv, miSignal.tv, which are entertainment contents, but also educational, where they're constantly broadcasting children contents through miSeñal.tv. And also Radionica, radio station developed a transmedia experiment, and we'd have to talk to them and to see if it was from the start that they did it or if it was just happening along the way thanks to the success that Radio Novela had, which is called the Radionica Detectives. They start with a radio novela, they go as a comic, and then they upload everything as a podcast, so, and now they're going to release a video game. So they start to enjoy and develop different or contents for different platforms based on successful content. So it is being done, it's being looked at, but we are aware that we have a significant challenge, and it is that we are bringing connectivity to different regions. We went from 200 townships connected, and towns and small towns, up to 1,078 in total, cities and towns that will be connected. We're multiplying by 5 connectivity in Colombia. We're going to be covering 96% of all Colombians being provided with broadband solution next year.
La historia, cuando uno mira eso desde la perspectiva de políticas públicas, es fundamental que el gobierno no solamente utilice la plataforma o las plataformas, sino que creen puertas a lo largo de ese pasillo donde el público general pueda unirse a la conversación acerca de las opciones y el desafío que está con las que un país y una cultura está confrontado. Porque hasta que la gente entienda que es su gobierno y que en esencia han participado en el desarrollo de sus políticas, van a ser observadores distantes de la implementación de esa política pública y no participarán en la evolución, en el progreso de ese gobierno.
Tomen notas, señores, tomen notas. Shall we go to the next question? And we're going to be moving forward on conversations. Jorge, this question is for you. The ministry has assumed a historic leadership in terms of connectivity, massification of the use of internet, and the appropriation of technologies. However, it could be said that in Latin America, we're still in our teenage years in the digital evolution. So what are the bottlenecks that exist regionally, so Latin America, for our countries to be able to go and move into an accelerated stage to appropriate everything digital?
Well, the main barrier, and we've even done surveys on digital culture of what people are doing with technology, why they use it, why they don't use it, and the answer is in precisely when you ask people why they're not using internet, and the answer is because I don't see any usefulness on it. And that is the main question that we need to break through. We need to get to the people and show them why you use internet. And we, from the ITC ministry, we start from the needs of the people. So we ask them if it's somebody who makes their living fixing nails or painting nails or polishing nails. Internet is not for an Excel sheet or for you to write fancy letters and a word processor, but the technology is for you to be able to see new ways of doing the nails and finding new styles, and so you will be able to get new clients. So if people see usefulness on the internet, in the internet actually, they're going to use it, and that makes it so that we have a significant challenge in the application, the generation of applications and contents, because if we do develop the application and contents that the people do like, and they love them, and they say, yeah, I do love internet because I see it usefulness here, people are going to, or if we develop those applications, people are going to use the internet, or they're going to use other types of technologies and ITCs. So I think that is a huge challenge to teach people and show them with great content, great applications, that technology can indeed change their life for good. So, Natalia, Sena is internationally recognized for their online educational platform. How do you see in the appropriation of those technologies, what are the bottlenecks? What do you find from the education and training perspective?
Well, thank you. Thank you all for sharing this panel with me. Well, we have had a significant challenge
having the largest virtual project, virtual training project in Latin America. We have almost 4 million people hung from a training platform with lots of difficulties. One of those difficulties is that we have not yet been able to fully teach people what this method is for training. So people basically abandon very easily the courses, or in the end, oftentimes they share, they've shared how getting into these training courses is not enough, because they have gaps in their training from other sources or other reasons that don't that preclude them from actually making the most out of it. So in terms of training, that's one of our challenges, how to make it so that our country, which came through or came into this very important project, which was very interesting for Colombians in all different regions, because we are from the Amazon to the Guajira, we have people on the platform. So how do we complement those other knowledges that are required in order to use or properly use all these means, not just visual but also the use of all these platforms? We are very enthusiastic about the work done by the Ministry of the ITCs, because the significant challenge is in the connectivity, but we are also aware that standing beside the connectivity and besides having created such a large project as this one, we need to fill gaps, key gaps that still exist in our population to be able to make effective use of those tools.
Great.
John? Tres cosas vienen a la mente. Sí, está bien hacer sugerencias. Entonces, lo primero es el poder de la nueva tecnología es tan extraordinario y tan diferente de todas las demás dinámicas que hayamos visto, que tenemos que invertir la manera, en la forma como la gente aprende en ella. Entonces, la directriz principal sería el Star Trek. Sería asegurarnos de que existe, que todas las escuelas en Colombia estén conectadas a la red, que los niños le enseñen a los padres cuál es la tecnología. Es mucho más fácil, mucho más cómodo si el ciclo de aprendizaje se ve invertido. Esa es la primera. La segunda, las telenovelas que han tenido tanto éxito, como ustedes mencionaron, con la desmovilización y esas otras cosas, deberían mostrar a la gente aprendiendo la tecnología, para que la gente pueda verse en las historias que ven, a las que escuchan y las que absorben. Y la tercera pieza sería, pídale a la gente que mande un video de 90 segundos a un sitio web que describa cómo la tecnología cambió su vida y el trabajo en el que se ocupan o su profesión. Si ustedes hacen eso, va a arrancar por su cuenta, pero utilizando el modelo de la era industrial, que es parar a un profesor en una sala enfrente a unos niños para enseñar, es diferente de aprender. Y la dinámica de aprendizaje va a venir de los jóvenes hacia los adultos mayores y de los colegas entre sí. Mauricio, how do you see this from the city's perspectives? Well, first of all, good afternoon, everybody, and all of you here. Mauricio and the panel members who are with us today. Well, the technology has to be seen, in my view, has to be used to achieve human goals, to put human beings in the center of concerns or solutions for of everything that's that he sets his mind to. MINTIC has been conducting or carrying out a very important task in terms of connectivity, and we are very happy to see that there is a Ministry of Information Technology and Communications in Colombia. It would be surprising to hear that there are many countries in Latin America that do not have such a ministry. We do have it. SENA has been carrying out a very magnificent job, one that has to do with training in certain areas for thousands of children or youngsters. I would think that from the perspective of the cities, or from the standpoint of the local governments, from the standpoint of regional institutions, if we look at what's being done today in terms of smart, intelligent cities, and what's being done nowadays from, or what is purported to be done from the city hall and the high council, high office for the ITCs, there are three main work lines which complement that which is being done. First of all, what Jorge just said, what are the ITCs good for? What's the usefulness of them? And this has to do with something that's basically called social appropriation of the ITCs. So there you have something as basic as being able to ensure basic access to the society of information by citizens. It's the case of the public Wi-Fi areas that we're installing in different areas in the city. And or, as our expert said, broadband connectivity for public schools, not just connectivity, because it's not enough for them to get connectivity to the IT or computer rooms, but also you need to have them. You have Wi-Fi in the different classrooms, so students and teachers can access the internet. That's not enough. I mean, you have to give them tablets for them to have access. That's not enough. Still, you need to give them virtual education platforms, and that's not enough. You have to change the chip in the teacher's head, as well as in the student's head, so that in the end, you'll get, or they'll have, what we call a change in the pedagogic model. And for the information technologies and communications become a part of the pedagogic model to leverage on the access to information and to leverage on the access to the society of knowledge. That is one of the work lines. I think the second one has to do with the ITCs as dynamizers of employment and economy. In the case of Bogota, for example, there's a city without a sea, without a river, whose industry conventionally is, conventional industry is being affected by the free trade agreement. Ask the shoemakers, ask the those who work in textiles and garments. The option of information and communications technologies, ICTs rather than ITCs, that it really becomes really strong. They become really strong. We have in Asia, the case of Manila, for example, and other cities. We see in those cities examples of how you can be, it's been possible to put outsourcing businesses online, and they're now competing against other cities in Asia Pacific and Korea that had taken the advantage or the lead, and they've been able to generate 16,000 employee jobs in the case of Philippines, for example, through the ICTs. Bogota has a significant opportunity to develop matters such as the economic train or locomotive based on the ICTs on account of their conditions. We're not going to detail them now or go into detail about them now. So I would believe that a third line, work line, is what's called improving the democratic governance based on ICT resources. That is, ensuring that there is transparency in the information by the governors or the rulers, actually, towards citizens. Ensuring that the programs implemented by the authorities, the directors of institutions, are known by the citizens, and that they can monitor them, track them, and oversee them socially through virtual means. Also ensuring that through the ICTs there will be greater participation, that a new form of participation by the citizens will be open in the handling of their own destinies. So I would summarize that in terms of social appropriation of ICTs. Two, ICTs to generate employment and entrepreneurship to generate for economic development. And three, ICTs to improve good government customs and in itself the government exercise or the government activities. Thank you, Mauricio. Let's go on to the next question, John. John, usted ha evidenciado cambios sociales muy importantes en todas las partes del mundo en las últimas tres décadas. Cuando usted analiza el papel que la tecnología, el periodismo y los medios han jugado en la primavera árabe y en otros movimientos masivos de expresión ciudadana como en Chile, Brasil, ¿cuál cree usted que son las implicaciones a largo plazo de este ciudadano globalmente empoderado? Entonces, probando que hay ciertas formas de arte asociadas con comunicaciones estratégicas. Yo pediría una transferencia de mensaje, pero primero quiero retomar un poquito la última pregunta, porque hay una dinámica muy interesante que he identificado al conducir alrededor de Bogotá. Primero, que no hay suficientes carros. Ustedes no tienen tráfico en absoluto, para nada. Segundo, hay una escasez de taxis amarillos. Y lo tercero es que si ustedes alguna vez han manejado por la ciudad con un dispositivo que está habilitado en Wi-Fi, cada vez que usted está en el tráfico que no existe, hay 25 a 30 señales de Wi-Fi que aparecen en su dispositivo móvil. Bogotá es una de las pocas ciudades a nivel global que tiene WiMAX, excepto que no está habilitado porque los usuarios no confían en los usuarios. Entonces, la primera empresa de negocios que llegue a encontrar una manera de monetizar la hackeada de los passwords van a tener WiMAX instantáneamente, no importa dónde estén en Bogotá. Eso es lo primero. Entonces, en relación con los cambios que he visto, pienso que una de las mejores partes acerca de mi trabajo es que yo soy un viejo nerd. Yo me paso 3 días al mes en Silicon Valley con nuevos fundadores de nuevas empresas que para mí se ven como si tuvieran 6 años y están hablando acerca de empresas que van a ganar miles de millones de dólares en los próximos 4 o 5 años. Y parte de eso es una conversación que empecé a tener más sobre tratar de identificar qué viene antes de que lo que venga llegue, especialmente en tecnología. Entonces ahora estoy pensando acerca de efectos de segundo y tercer orden de las tecnologías emergentes. Google tiene el Google Car, que ya lo hemos visto en línea, si no, búsquenlo por favor. Pero los carros en el futuro no distante, y esto es difícil de imaginarse en Bogotá, si ustedes han utilizado un vehículo aquí o si han estado cerca de un vehículo, pero en 10 años los vehículos se van a manejar a sí mismos. Ustedes van a ser pasajeros del vehículo y ellos van a poder empatar más vehículos en el espacio. Ya sé que en Bogotá es imposible, pero bueno, siempre se pueden meter más carros en los huecos de las vías. Y si ustedes piensan en las consecuencias psicológicas de las tecnologías emergentes, una de las cosas que suceden con los vehículos sin conductor es que es otro aspecto del poder que se le quita al individuo. Entonces, a los individuos les gusta creer que están en control de algo. Entonces, los carros sin conductor van a eliminar ese aspecto y se va a manifestar en la sociedad civil de una manera diferente. Uno de los primeros, de los grandes hallazgos que hemos visto en este cambio, y gracias por la mención de los 30 años, en los cambios que se han dado en los últimos 3 años, es este concepto de que debido a la tecnología, nadie nunca está solo. Si usted tiene un punto de vista, usted puede encontrar a alguien con un punto de vista similar, incluso si nunca los conocen en el espacio físico. Así que nunca realmente están solos, y eso significa que ninguna idea realmente está sola. El punto que consideraría con los movimientos sociales es que siempre ha habido movimientos sociales. Esto no es un nuevo fenómeno. Y me recuerda lo que un amigo, muy buen amigo mío, describió como el síndrome de Cristóbal Colón. Y es que si es nuevo para usted, el que sea nuevo para usted no significa que sea nuevo. Y en ese espacio, los movimientos sociales han sido empoderados antes, marcaron diferencias en los gobiernos, la calle siempre ha pedido mayor participación. Y ahora, lo que hace la tecnología es que permite que esos conjuntos de creencias se aceleren y mantengan velocidades que no llegamos ni siquiera a entender muchas veces. Y entonces, que es una caracterización de un movimiento, una idea que es una caracterización de un movimiento, puede pasar de un país a otro en menos tiempo de lo que me tomó a mí decir eso. Pero hay ciertos riesgos asociados con eso también. Y un muy buen amigo mío, Eli Persher, que creó movement.org y ahora está arrancando en Nueva York en algún lugar, él describe esto como la burbuja filtro. Y tenemos que definir eso, porque en caso de que alguien nos esté viendo en televisión o que esté aquí, entre en línea y utilice el verbo y sustantivo a la vez, que se llama Google, y si ustedes creen que están buscando por su cuenta, por encima de su hombro hay un algoritmo acosador invisible que está registrando cada tecla que usted toca. Ahora, Google le va a decir, igual que Facebook, igual que Twitter, que estábamos haciendo esto para expandir y mejorar la experiencia del usuario. Entonces, lo que sucede cuando ustedes hacen búsquedas es que la mayoría de la gente hoy en día, particularmente en un contexto político, solamente busca esa información que reafirme los conjuntos de creencias preexistentes. Nadie va en línea a mostrarse o a probar que están equivocados. Entonces lo que está faltando en el espacio es el concepto de mediación, que era antes el papel de los medios, y ya los medios han agregado eso porque por los modelos de ingresos. Entonces lo que Eli Perisher hizo es que tomó dos amigos. Un amigo está muy interesado en los eventos actuales y el otro amigo simplemente disfruta la vida. Y hizo que estas dos personas buscaran la misma palabra en exactamente el mismo momento en el tiempo. Y la palabra era Egipto. Y la persona que disfruta la vida y todo eso sacó tours en el Nilo y todos los viajes que pueden, eso le pareció a las pirámides, todos los viajes a las pirámides. La persona que pasa tiempo mirando eventos de actualidad, miró las recibió las noticias de los motines, todos los problemas de las ONGs y el cambio de gobierno en Egipto. Entonces, si ustedes piensan por un segundo que cuando ustedes hacen una búsqueda, ustedes están haciendo una búsqueda profunda, encontrando toda la información que está disponible sobre el tema, ustedes están equivocados, están encontrando aquella información que está disponible sobre un tema basada en sus hábitos de búsqueda anteriores. Y eso crea una vulnerabilidad fundamental y un daño a las democracias. Jeff, tomémonos ese punto. Y bueno, hablamos de los aspectos positivos de Transmedia, pero hablemos de las tecnologías que George está describiendo, las búsquedas como observador. ¿Qué le preocupa a usted acerca de esta convergencia de expresión ciudadana, movimiento y tecnología? Bueno, hay una preocupación. En la medida en que facciones y ciertos tipos de personas se vuelven más conocedoras, o incluso en la medida en que una práctica de transmedia se vuelve más divulgada, más popularizada, mucho dinero y esfuerzo puede ser metido o invertido en la creación de una atmósfera de realidad en torno a un punto de vista específico, un punto de vista que puede ser disruptivo, que puede estar muy sesgado hacia un grupo pequeño que gana mucho dinero. Y existe el peligro, hemos visto evidencia incluso en Estados Unidos de que ciertos esfuerzos pueden hacerse para hacer que la gente perciba lo que no es en absoluto cierto. Hubo duda generalizada y continúa viéndola acerca del cambio climático global. Yo miré a mi ventana en la décima avenida y vi el río cómo se acercaba más cerca a mi casa. Y algo está pasando, pero hay una gran cantidad de dinero que ha sido invertida en un tipo como de multiplataforma, un esfuerzo transmedia casi que acordado y multiplataforma. Si ellos supieran realmente cómo crear y diseñar transmedia excepcional, todos nosotros podríamos ser engañados en creer que nada en absoluto está pasando y que nada es un problema. Sí tenemos que ser extremadamente cuidadosos. Por eso es que yo soy defensor del alfabetismo de medios, para entender, todos debemos entender profundamente cómo filtrar lo que está pasando alrededor de nosotros y cómo poder ser nuestros propios contradictores. Eso es un problema significativo, creo yo, John, que delineaste en cuanto a Google. Pero nosotros como individuos debemos explorar la otra cara de nuestro argumento, de nuestra razón. Todos queremos tener la razón, pero si estamos tan en lo cierto, no vamos a ver algo que se nos está metiendo sin darnos cuenta y rodeándonos y creando una realidad que es tan fantástica como una película de fantasía o algo así. Yo creo que eso que no es algo demasiado sofisticado o avanzado para hacerse. Mi equipo ya está, por ejemplo, examinando el SENA, que yo considero es una institución maravillosa. En principio, es sorprendente. Yo quisiera que Estados Unidos tuviera ese tipo de organización o de estructura organizacional que pudiera tomar a aquellos que están en los bordes de la sociedad, pues, y entrenarlos de esa manera. Imaginen sobrecargar, turbocargar más bien, una institución como esa con técnicas avanzadas y prácticas de última tecnología. Podemos hablar, claro que podemos hablar. Gracias. Natalia. What's your take on it as a citizen, as an observer? What are you concerned about that convergence between technology and citizen expression? Well, I think that in addition to the complex situation that our country is going through, I find this as a point in favor, actually. I mean, way in favor of being able to contribute a grain of sand to improve our condition. We've lived many years with problems of being able to express ourselves. People haven't been able to express themselves. They haven't been able to share their points of view, create their own groups and associations. And so this time that we're in and that will allow, this can be a window of opportunity to overcome the major conflict that we have. Now, clearly, with all the rigorousness and the structure and everything that could lead to prevent us from going into a worse situation that we're in, actually. But I think that in the end, these types of expressions in our country have been liberating. And I think that all of this scheme has been for many youngsters who, even today, because they are so much in the forefront of technology, they don't measure the size of the problem that we had a couple of years ago when we didn't used to have these media and when it was so hard to express ourselves. So I'm betting on this definitely. And with all the responsibility that it demands, putting the people into, or bringing them into a circle where this is meant to be used for good and not bad. But I think that for countries like the conflict that are experiencing the conflict that Colombia is living through, this is a great tool, independently from whether in other countries there may have been used improperly or anything. I mean, I think for us, it can be a very good way out from or towards overcoming a conflict or even a human situation, which for Colombians used to be very complicated. Thank you. Let's continue with you. Let's stay with you. Many say this is the decade of Latin America. However, a big part of the economic growth and prosperity that we're living comes from sectors such as mining, oil, and other traditional industries. Some analysts are asking themselves if our region is creating knowledge societies in the long run. What is your vision of what human capital means for Latin America and how education needs to be potentialized and revamped to make the most out of these opportunities from the decade of Latin America, as it's called? Well, I think that the countries in Latin America, independently from what we have done thus far, are starting to move forward in realizing that we have at least strongly, I'd say, we have three major large opportunities.
First is that anyhow, the world's economy and the items of world's economy are changing. Yes, we have funded a lot with oil, copper, I say the entire Latin America. But this item, say, of services, of another level of things is also increasing, inclusive in Latin America, very strongly. So we have many investors from the world saying that if you don't develop that, you are the door of opportunity. You have to do it in this way because, say, our market in many places is full already. That happens in SENA. We receive many foreign investors that say, hey, we need people to work in KPO or BPO. And they are delayed in that. So that shows us that we have a very big opportunity there that we have not explored yet. Second is that technology favors a lot the Latin American countries in their own condition. We are not countries that we have achieved a very high industrialization, as you say. We are primary, and the technology and the easiness of access to technology allows us taking advantage of that opportunity, because we would not need to make big investments or waiting for decades to become industrialized countries to take advantage of those opportunities, those changes in the economic items are in the countries. And last, we are also growing economies, and we ourselves need to realize that we have great development opportunities internally. Someone was saying here that basically the use of technology has to deal also with seeing the usages with which the people knows what it is and how useful it is for them. In that sense, one takes their one's iPad and looks for those apps, and almost all of them are created for Europe or the States, and almost none is created for the needs of the Latin American countries. So there we have a door for opportunities that is very big. Here in Colombia, we have to talk about Taxi, which is an app for taxi in Bogota. I mean, I don't know where else, but I think that from there, we have a lot to do, just to say it in that way, in these countries. Therefore, I believe that those three opportunity windows will take us to very quickly, and I am telling this because of Sena, we have to give a very big leap or transformation. And that is because all this is done with people. All of this is done with human capital. Nothing of that has been done despite the technology. In many sectors, we have been able to do a lot without human capital because we have been able to enlarge our productions. But in this subject and before information technologies, everything is done with people. And for that reason, it is so important for us to put in the first line the development of those people, the material, intellectual development of those people, because it is that combination which will help us take advantage of this opportunity. That's why everything we do is not less. I mean, everything we do will not be an exit. In Sena, we have almost 100,000 people training themselves in information and communication technologies. But even then, we have a very big challenge, because that is and that is not. We say that we are training people and that, but given that the technology is going so quick, very quickly we have been lagged in training something that was in fashion or in force 3 or 5 years ago. So we have to look for the break-even point where we can remain always in the reality before technology. This morning we were mentioning that is how to change an instruction process, to take out of ourselves the traditional teaching process, because it's the only way we can be updated and we can give some education that is updated with technology. And there we have a challenge. Sena is an entity 56 years old that I believe that for this sector would have to change considerably, at least during the next 2 years. Well, Mauricio, how do you connect? I mean, you talk about industrial industries, traditional industries in Bogota. How do you connect that part with human capital, education, and what is coming in the future? Well, there are different elements that allow creating a better climate or environment for that connection between conventional industry and education is given, that is undertaken by bodies such as SENA and other entities. I think that in the first place, it is necessary to elevate the level of the ICT culture as a whole. It is essential for the citizen to learn or to know or to be familiarized better with the different possibilities that the ICTs give. The use of ICTs in their diversity, not only in the Twitters or in the web pages or and the emails, but all the applications that the ICTs contribute nowadays that pass over the all the applications in society, in medicine and work, and the data referencing, I mean, geographical data, and the huge amount of applications. So there is a need to elevate the level of culture of the citizens with respect to ICTs, better understanding on the use application of ICTs. That makes us to schedule for the October, the ICT month, we have denominated an event called Bogota ISTIC, ICT, and all the locations to develop multiple initiatives to show precisely the use and applications of ICTs and to elevate that cultural level. That's the first point. Second, I think that we have to make a difference between generating economy based upon the ICT industry, based upon the new IT-based companies, which is essential, but above all, to attain for the ICTs to be incorporated by the traditional conventional industry, by all productive processes, because that evidently allows competing with the other markets. It allows generating efficiencies, allows generating revenues and surpluses. That is a large battle, and in that sense, I believe that the teaching or the training that the SENA is making on other entities should be focused on the apprentices, people that are taught to perform different works. They have to include the ICT component as part of those economic activities. I reiterate, one thing is to develop ICT industries, and another thing is to take the ICTs to the industries. That is a fundamental part to get to that point. And then, let's say that there is another subject that is very expensive for us, in the sense that it must exist a public policy so that the ICTs have a north point, and they advance into different fields coherently and articulated. Say that it is different to fix a north for the different governments to have the north and not go in some other places as a function of the color perceptions they have. And for that reason, we believe that cities, and in particular Bogota, require a master ICT plan. In other words, to set a public policy of ICTs through a vehicle, which is the master plan of ICTs, and in that master plan to incorporate very strongly the subject of industry and the adequate training for that industry with an ICT component. Master plan that, among other things, has to be concerted with the set of the digital eco-world, those actors. It is not around a magic hat for gurus who know very well the ICT subjects that a master plan is built, but under concertation and participation of the different alive ICT forces of the country or of the city. I think those are elements that partially respond to that. Any idea, algunas ideas sobre capital humano? Sí, mencioné antes. Gasté un poquito de tiempo en Silicon Valley, estuve. Este desafío de aprendizaje ha golpeado a Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley está hecho, consiste en 9 condados alrededor de San Francisco. Los 9 condados forman Silicon Valley, son las 16 economías globales más grandes. En este momento, el problema más grande que tiene Silicon Valley es encontrar a un ingeniero de computación. ¿Ya? Google quiere contratar 1,000 ingenieros de computación y no los puede encontrar. Facebook quiere contratar 750 ingenieros de computación y no los puede encontrar. Todos los smart apps, los pequeños que mencioné, están buscando 2 o 3. Y miren, esto es lo que pasa. Son $150,000 de salario básico y $150,000 en opciones de acciones y patrimonio. Y las personas que firman ese negocio de $150,000 tienen un bono de $150,000. Entonces este paquete es $450,000 y ellos no pueden encontrar a la gente. Y lo que ellos quieren no son personas que acaben de salir de la universidad, sino personas que han estado por lo menos 3 años en el mercado, porque una vez que han estado en el mercado 3 años, ellos han
desaprendido lo que les enseñaron en la universidad y entienden lo que es una empresa realmente. El desafío para la educación en esto es no enseñarle a las personas para el día a día, sino que enseñarles para la economía futura, para que cuando las personas se gradúen en cualquier programa educativo que tenga, en cualquier universidad que tenga o asistan, están listos para entrar a la fuerza de trabajo y no tienen que desaprender todo, porque si todos vendimos en el momento. Lo que es interesante aquí en Silicon Valley es la corrección de la eficiencia en la educación está siendo hecha por el mercado. Entonces, permitirle al mercado resolver el problema de hoy, que porque sus instituciones se concentran en un arco de lo que luciría, en un arco de lo cómo luciría la economía en 5 o 10 años, para que constantemente no tengan la misma discusión acerca de educación remedial. Es increíble lo que está haciendo el sector privado en términos de educación. Jorge, I believe that we are changing and we are strengthening a lot creativity industries and based upon human talent very quickly. And I will not refer to studies, but simply to the situation that Colombia 3.0 gives. In Colombia 3.0, we had approximately 7,000 attendees, 31,000 visitors to the streaming. That gives us a size of 40,000 people interested in the agenda of Colombia 3.0. That means that there are 40,000 people interested in the digital content industry that definitely are either undertaking something or going to be part of a study. On the other hand, we brought 100 lecturers approximately. We talked to them and one says many of them had not come to Colombia, and those who had come 3 or 4 years ago, they said, this is changing very quickly. And those who had not come, they said, I did not imagine this was happening in Colombia, the quality of video games, the quality of the apps that they are creating. So we do have, on the one hand, the interest. It is demonstrated that Colombia 3.0, around 40,000 people interested in those contents that were contents of, say, a high level content. People had to know something to understand the contents of Colombia 3.0, so there are people interested in this industry. And on the other hand, there are companies that are doing quality things. What it is in the middle is a very big task that we share with XENA, which is preparing and taking those 40,000 people or more, and I'm sure that there are much more, to a level that allows us to compete on a global basis. But definitely there is evidence that we have talent, we're doing the things correctly, and we have to add a lot and to realize that although we are doing okay with respect to preparation of human talent, we do have a lot to do. ¿Alguna cosa? ¿Alguien quiere hablar sobre la educación y el capital humano? Hey, damas aquí, ¿pueden levantar la mano para ver cuántas mujeres hay aquí? Miren eso, miren eso. Eso es increíble para mí. Porque esto es una conferencia tecnológicamente orientada y he notado que hay una cantidad de damas ahí. ¿Y adivinen qué? La organización más grande en este país es la de ella. Está manejada y empoderada por una mujer brillante y empoderada. ¿Estamos en lo cierto? Bueno, espero que sí estén de acuerdo. Lo que también estoy notando, sin embargo, es que este país todavía está emergiendo detrás de las sombras o debajo de las sombras. Y esa sombra ha dejado una actitud que está muy fija. La disparidad entre los ricos y los pobres, arreglada o corregida en las mentes de muchos, la voluntad de convertirse en algo especial, de convertirse en un empresario, para sobresalir de la multitud, es algo que yo todavía pienso que muchos jóvenes, adultos jóvenes, están un poco nerviosos para hacer. Creo que la narrativa tiene que cambiar, el discurso tiene que cambiar, porque va a pasar bastante tiempo antes de que estas instituciones grandes metan la tecnología futura. Van a tener que construir relaciones y establecer mucho para poderle dar a los estudiantes lo que ellos necesitan para ser competitivos, no solamente en el mercado colombiano, sino en el mercado global, el cual Colombia, para el que Colombia se está alistando, yo creo. Entonces, las personas jóvenes van a tener que ser activadas para que persigan lo que ven detrás y ser motivadas para ir detrás de ese software que va a darles la ventaja competitiva. Tienen que ser entusiastas y mucho más incluso la sociedad que está alrededor de ellos para poder perseguir o ir tras esto. Ese es el discurso que yo espero que los medios, que las organizaciones como el SENA y que sus gobiernos en cierta forma se despierten para eso y comiencen a desarrollar. No es un discurso fácil para desarrollar. Algunos de nosotros estamos muy, pero muy divididos en este país. Pero yo pienso que va a haber puntos comunes que van a surgir, lo cual permitirá que nosotros podamos tumbar todos esos patrones viejos de pensamiento y para irnos a la carga, para la ocasión, para estar al punto de la ocasión. Porque el entusiasmo que yo veo de ustedes, mi feed de Twitter ha subido cientos de personas. Eso nunca ha pasado en una sola conferencia. Colombia 3.0 ha disparado los que me siguen en Twitter, unos 300 personas. Y 55 salieron del SENA, que es muy chévere para mí. Y eso me muestra que este país está listo, está emocionado y está saliendo a ese umbral, pero pueden estar un poquito nerviosos acerca de pasar ese umbral. Para eso necesitamos una buena historia, un tema que nos una o un discurso para que nos lleve al futuro. Pensemos sobre eso. Bueno, grandioso, tenemos solo un par de minutos que nos quedan. Lo que creo que vamos a hacer, I'm going to talk in Spanish. What we will do to close, we don't have too much time. I would like for each one of you very briefly to close some conclusions, perhaps some advice to the thousands of people who are in this streaming or here in this auditorium to close the subject. Mauricio, let's start with you, please, for the last part of this panel. Well, let us search as people, as individuals, to develop an attitude that is to combine in being producers, protagonists of what we do, and to be able to convey, to communicate that, to report that, to share that, to be producers and consumers at the same time, in the sense that we can take advantage of the good that is produced by the others as well, that the societies generate, and that internet and the information society allows us to know, is to be prosumers. Thank you. Entonces, antes de ofrecer un consejo, quiero agradecerle a Colombia 3.0 por tenernos aquí, agradecerle a Mauricio por ser moderador. Y muy importante, en esa pequeña caja, quiero agradecer a estas personas por hacer un trabajo grandioso en la traducción simultánea. Gracias. Tengo dos consejos para las personas que están en la audiencia. Lo primero es, no teman en lo que hagan. No tengan miedo de nada. Richard Bach, que era un filósofo americano, una vez escribió que si usted discute por sus propias limitaciones, con seguro serán sus limitaciones. Sea apasionado acerca de lo que hace. Tenga el ojo del tigre y el corazón de un león. Nunca pare hasta que logre su objetivo. Y lo segundo es reconocer el hecho de que hemos hablado de Colombia como nación. Pero lo que pasa es que el futuro es la imaginación. Y si ustedes pueden imaginar un futuro, ustedes pueden hacer que ese futuro sea una realidad.
Well, thanks. And this space to me is fascinating because I'm always motivated when I feel that there are young people around me. I think that's one of the tasks that I came to comply here, which was to be closer to the young people. Life put me in Sena, and it's putting me in spaces like this where I have to tell the young people something similar to what they have said already, which is we can build in this so rich and valuable and pretty country, we can build many things, and those things happen. We don't have to wait for many years or for a dream that is not going to be accomplished, but in this country things can happen. And the sector, for those who are interested in the ICTs, many things happen. We have to just leave the dreams to fly. I mean, the dreams to be consolidated little by little. And I think that precisely is in these territories where the young people find much more appropriation of their lives, because they very quickly find that the things they want can be consolidated. In Sena, for many of the young people who are listening to us, we also make many things a reality. In Colombia, there is no need to tell the young people to go to Sena. Many of them go there. More than 1 million young people go there. More than 7 million people study there. But with Sena, you can count. You get into the Sena's webpage. There are many opportunities in the techno parks, many opportunities in the teaching centers or education centers that these young people can use to, as a tool to make those dreams come true that do come through in Colombia. Well, with this closing of Colombia 3.0, what I would say is, first, and gathering what Jeff and John said, the work we're doing for the digital content industry, and many of us are doing from the ICT ministry, but also from the SENA, from the Chamber of Commerce, from the Ministry of Culture on the government side, and most likely many others in Colciencias, and on the private side with all the associations, companies, there is like a very interesting marriage that we are doing. The public-private alliance that has been talked a lot about in Colombia. I think that the work we are doing for the digital content industry, that is becoming a reality. And a sample of this is Colombia 3.0. As John said, we are not afraid. And in Colombia 3.0, we were not afraid on making a new format and daring, doing something big, something that had not been done in Colombia, just to take an area of a city to hold several events at the same time, to be entertaining and funny, not the typical event. We did it with a lot of passion, as Jeff said, and that's the way we do with everything we do. And we imagine the future, and the future of Colombia 3.0 is to become the most important summit in Latin America. And I believe that this year we are achieving to be the Latin American referral for an event. I take advantage of the fact that there are many people here who made possible this event, and this event cannot finish without thanking them. Most likely I will forget a lot of them, but Lorna, Andres Muñoz, Maria Elvira Muñoz, the entire team of digital contents, Angelica Malu, all the people from the ICT ministry, the tip of Out of the Loop, Felipe, all the people of Seagraft, Momo, Bogodé. I think if I continue, I will end up by midnight. Julian, the Chamber of Commerce. Who? Andres Muñoz, of course, there was a sound there. Of course, the district, Sena, all the international lecturers who, I mean, this was very positive that I want to share with you. This year we didn't have to call and
tell what Colombia 3.0 is, or to convince people that Bogota is secure, because before we had, now we had to say our agenda is full, but the lecturers called us to wanting to participate in this event. To all those people who make Colombia 3.0 to be possible, thanks a million. We have a huge challenge that is doing it next year bigger and with many teachings that we have from this Colombia 3.0. Thanks to all, Juan Sebastián, the lawyer, thank you very much. And obviously this thanks to the minister, Diego Milano, and the vice minister. ¿Listos? Algunas de estas maravillosas personas hablaron de temor, de miedo y de no tener miedo. Por el otro lado tenemos la ira, la molestia, y algunos de nosotros tenemos ira, estamos bravos. Por favor, miren mi situación. Yo nací en una situación negativa. No tenía nada bueno. Soy latino. Hay una cierta lazo que nos une, que compartimos. Cosas terribles nos pueden suceder y podemos estar muy bravos y tener esa rabia y usarla para reafirmar nuestra percepción negativa del mundo. Podemos utilizarla para aislarnos y para echarle la culpa a otros. Pero si yo hubiera hecho eso, no estaría sentado con una cantidad de personas aquí que están poniendo impacto al mundo en forma positiva, y eso para mí es increíble. ¿Cómo hice esto? Yo utilicé la rabia, ese es un poquito de consejo, lo siento, utilicé la rabia como un combustible para poder lograr mi voluntad. Y yo quería ser exitoso, si solamente era para mostrarle a todos los que dudaban que es posible. Bueno, está bien tener rabia, simplemente utilícenla como un combustible de cohetes. No soy un genio, no luzco como Brad Pitt tampoco. De alguna forma, cosas increíbles han sido logradas por mí y por mi equipo. Ustedes también pueden hacer esto. Es muy, pero muy posible, y quiero que ustedes piensen acerca de eso cuando se vayan a casa. Y piensen acerca de eso, que todo el mundo está soñando. Y luego salgan mañana y comiencen a tratar de hacer su voluntad en una forma que le va a dar algo al mundo, porque todos sabemos que cuando damos y damos con generosidad de espíritu, eso no necesariamente es, no es, esperamos que algo nos llegue. Con frecuencia suceden cosas buenas. Nunca se den por vencidos. Well, just to close this, to wrap up, I would say that truly we can say with what happened with these 3 days and all the work done in the public and private sector, Colombia is truly a digital nation, and we're telling the world that we are. Thank you very much to all the people who are in the streaming, and we'll see each other in the party. I invite you in Zona T, we will have some music of some groups, Super Litio among them. And then for those who continue with energy after this music, in Armando Records we will drink something to refresh ourselves. So this is not over yet, guys. Thanks.